in here?
No, it was just not.
Hey, everybody.
Hey.
Wow. I just got to say that after Tiffany's sermon, I was feeling pretty touched. Because I had this idea of coming in here and just giving God my all, and I'm going to do that, but I just had this really flashy image in my head, and now it's just it's totally out the window. You know, when I see, sometimes it just takes humanity's sinfulness and just the death and destruction of the world to just really show us how good God really is. And my best friend is like a Max. He's in Afghanistan, and I remember the day when on his Facebook status, it was just, you know, I've been hit by shrapnel, not sure what's happening next. And I don't know, you know, it wasn't the first time that I've talked to somebody who's been to war, and it's really tough stuff. So I'm really glad though that we all have a chance to practice the sermons, and not only is this practice though, but this is a real chance for us to share gospel truth with Christians. You know, a lot of times we forget that Paul and the New Testament is addressed to Christians. You know, continue in the faith. 1 Thessalonians, I was looking at this morning as I prepared my heart to just do a little review of the sermon that I'm doing right now. It's just saying, with deep conviction and joy in the Spirit and the power that comes from the Spirit, you know, share God's word. And, yeah, so I just want to thank Don. You know, we all love Don. So. Kind of going off of what Tiffany said, I had a similar opening spiel about Christmas. Christmas is a special time for everybody in this room. Christmas is a time that we share, that we all go through the Spirit around MNU. And, you know, for me, working in Campus Center, most of you know I work there, and they always play Christmas music in the back nonstop, so it's like, but when I was growing up, Christmas, and still is, the thing that I look forward to the most. I look forward to it because it's when I get presents. I used to hide under the couch and wait with my sister for Santa because he was supposed to come at midnight. That was back in the day, but I always used to fall asleep before midnight. But for some people, Christmas is not the best time of the year. Christmas is another reminder of that it's another anniversary of the time that it just... the time that we lost Mom, or the time that we lost Dad, or it's another Christmas without this loved one, or that loved one. And so what do we do with that bad Christmas, though? I mean, I call it a bad Christmas. I don't mean, you guys know what I mean. It's the Christian response. You know, I'm always reading Christian literature, I'm always reading books, I'm always watching sermons, and I hear a lot of pastors and I hear from other people say things like, you know, don't tell them, like, all things work together for the good of those who love him, you know. Don't, you know, just be there with the person and listen to them, and don't come at them with the Bible and with God, and just the presence of listening. And someone said something to me once, like, Christians are usually the first ones to love, but the last ones to show understanding. And I think that's right, because I think as Christians, we, myself included, we know and we believe so much, and we know what the ultimate good is God, and so we just want to tell them all about God, but we forget sometimes, myself included, that presence and listening, just listening to God and listening to the person, they're just, you can't have one without the other. It's like, love God, love neighbor, can't do one without the other. It's the same thing. And I don't know, I started thinking, what would God say in that situation? If it were God, and he were to say something to someone having that bad Christmas, what would God say? What would he say? So I turned to God's answer, the Bible. It's the word of God. It's the word of truth, the word of life. I turned to Isaiah 7. I really love the Bible. I'm obsessed with the Bible. I got this cool cover, you know. And someone said, like, the more beat up the cover, the more you use the Bible. It just fell in my car. It's just like, I got these tabs all over it. I love the Bible. I love it. And so, I look at Isaiah 7. So what's going on in Isaiah 7? We've been hearing a lot about Isaiah 7 lately. So, you know, we have this story about Ahaz and the kingdoms of, we got Assyria way up here, and then we have the northern and the southern, okay, like Israel, or Ephraim is another name for Israel, then we have Judah down low, and they have their own king, their own courts, then we have this guy Isaiah, who's a prophet, he's a prophet of God. A lot of times we pass over that kind of quick. Well, this guy's a prophet, all right? And what's going on with the whole prophet thing? Well, he comes from a long line of prophets, actually. And the prophets in the Bible are God's medium, God's mediator, God's mouthpiece. You know, he says, you know, thus saith the Lord, the formula you find in the prophets. It's as if God is using them to communicate his truth. Just like one day Jesus himself communicating God's truth. But also is God, the ultimate fulfillment. So we have Ahaz, right? We have this guy. And, there's this pretty big enemy, Assyria, who's been conquering and destroying, and they're ravenous. Ravenous after. The Assyrians are a pretty brutal people. A lot of the ancient peoples are known for their torture tactics. You guys might think of the crucifixion. Pretty barbaric people, and they're coming down. And so Ahaz is really considering this offer he got from the king of Ephraim, who has aligned himself with Syria or Aram. And, you know, it's, let's join together and form a coalition. You know, we've been enemies in the past. I've even attacked you recently. But right now we have a common enemy. We don't band together. We're all going to die. So how about we just get together and ignore God, whatever. And, let's take out this enemy. Just like that. It'd be super easy. It's really appealing to Ahaz. You know, here's tons of horses, tons of chariots, tons more. A lot of times we like to read into this that Ahaz is scared and he's afraid, because we read those four things that Don pointed out to us. To be careful, keep calm, don't be afraid, don't lose heart. I love those, but I see those as something God is saying to Ahaz. Because Ahaz is, I don't know, I don't think he's really afraid. When I look at the passage in context, I turn to Isaiah 8:6. The people have rejected the flowing waters of Shiloah, and they rejoice over Rezin and the son of Remaliah. I see the people are actually, they're not shaking in their knees, or the trees, like it says. There's something more going on here. The people are excited, and they've given in to this idea that foreign nations, whose God is not God, whose people don't obey God, are their help and their source of salvation instead of God. And so what were the Assyrians going to do to Judah? Well, they're going to destroy it. They're going to kill it. And I got to thinking about this idea of Assyria coming to destroy Judah, and I thought to myself, how do you kill a country? You can't kill a country. Well, a country is made up of people, and we know from history and from things that are happening right now that you can't kill a country, and you can't kill all of its people, but you can do all sorts of things to completely devastate a country. And that's what the latter half of Isaiah 7 is all about. You know, it's talking about the king of Assyria is like a razor to shave the head and the hair of your legs. That's an expression of complete shame. Take your beards also, talking about the goats and the cows, and that they're going to completely devastate the land. And when I look at the Bible and I see this, I see poetic language. I also see literal language. I see both being fulfilled. And what I see is a picture of the exile as the suffering Christ. I see the crucifixion of the nation of Judah. So what that is the very tribe from which Jesus hails from, Judah, being crucified by God's enemies, by the world, by Assyria. It's a picture of crucifixion. But can I say something here? Who is really suffering at this point? They haven't been to war yet. It's a prophecy. Talking about foretelling instead of foretelling. That's a prophecy to be fulfilled very soon. And there's a lot of things that are going on for the original audience that sometimes we kind of miss. What's really going on here is God's love, is what's going on. God loves Ahaz. I haven't heard anyone say that yet. I'm sure someone would have. But it's God's love for Ahaz. He's saying, Ahaz, please listen to me. You know, I will show you a sign, even though you don't even ask for one, I'm going to show you one. You know, it's just like, it's the real person suffering, besides Isaiah, I think would be God. I think that God remembers those Christmases when he lost his loved ones. I think that God remembers those times when we turned and fell from him. And I think God suffers. I think Jesus is the, you know, like Colossians says, he's the image of the invisible God. And he, as Hebrews says, he's the exact representation of God. And I think that there's a pattern all throughout Scripture that reveals to us that our God is a suffering God. And it's interesting to me, too, in that Isaiah passage that Emmanuel, I was reading up on the Hebrew, means more closely in the Hebrew, with us, God, not God with us. And so I get to thinking about this theme of Jesus being a human just like us. Jesus is a human just like us. He's the God that suffers, that's crucified, that's put to shame, just like the nation of Israel would be completely put to shame. They would be forced out of their homes, forcibly plundered. They used nose rings that they strung together and they led the exiles out. All this is about shame, captivity, and exile by the world, which is the same thing that happened to Christ. And so I see a very large and recapitulation theme. What I see happening there. And I also see Isaiah, God's chosen that he also accepted. Remember from his vision in the previous chapter. I see Isaiah as the suffering servant of Christ. And so in this battle of self-crucifixion that God undergoes continuously for us, once again, God offers to Ahaz peace, redemption. He offers to him love and grace. He extends his hand. Just listen to me. Everything in this passage is pointing to God. It's really awesome. Let me see here. Yes, I have the Message translation, which I think Tiffany used, which I really enjoy. So it's just from verses 5 and 6. Aaron, along with Ephraim's son, Remaliah, have plotted to do you harm. So, the nations that you think will help you defeat your common enemy, Assyria, are actually going to turn on you. So not only is it a bad idea because you think that these people are going to help you defeat some sort of cool coalition, destroy the common enemy, they're going to turn on you before... Well, when I read the text, I think it kind of sounds like they're going to turn on you before Assyria even comes. They're going to forcibly take your throne so that way they can impress gang, your army, to... follow me and not Ahaz. They're going to depose Ahaz. So they're plotting to take over your army. They're going to do you harm. They've conspired against you, saying, let's go to war against Judah. Dismember it. Take it for ourselves. Set up a puppet king over it. But this is what God has to say about it. God says it's not going to happen. Reading from the Message once again. Nothing will come of it. Because the capital of Aram is Damascus, and the king of Damascus is a mere man raised. As for Ephraim, in 65 years it's going to be rubble, nothing left of it. This is awesome. Right here in my exegesis, which my exegesis process, which was really enlightening to me, it was just this idea that God is so in charge that in the NIV he's saying the head of Aram, the king, or the head of the nation, kind of, you know, in the Hebrew mind, this is hard for the Western mind to kind of understand. Nations and people, they're representative people. So we get this idea of Adam and Jesus as the representative heads of a people or of a spirituality or of a nation. But even though they're representative heads, they're also real individuals. Just like Ahaz is a real individual, or like Raisin is a real individual. So God says in the NIV, he says, you know, the head of Damascus is only resin. Only resin. And he goes down a little bit. It goes down a little bit to the head of Samaria is only Remaliah's son. You know, it's only like, like here, this guy's a king in a city I created, in an earth that I created, in a universe that I created, in a cosmos that I sustain and govern moment to moment by my very breath. So here's a guy who thinks he's pretty powerful, and then here's me who created, like literally created the universe by doing this. I mean, there's no comparison there. Everything I see in this chapter is about God reinforcing himself. He's just saying, please listen to me. Please, I'm the better option. I love you. I just want the best for you. I want to save you. I want you to enjoy long life. I want you to come into my kingdom. But Ahaz is convinced that the kingdom is actually his. Got excited there. And so the message reflects a Hebrew play on words. God speaks to people in ways that God's people can understand, in ways that they remember, and in ways that impact them. He speaks to them in signs. So I think Tiffany also quoted this, which was awesome. If you don't take your stand in faith, you won't even have a leg to stand on. So in other words, it's a little play on words there. Ask anything, God says. Anything and I'll show you. He's speaking through Isaiah. He says, ask God for a sign that it is all true, whether in the deepest depths or in the highest heavens. In the message, ask God for the moon, really capturing the sentiment of what he's saying. Ask God to do anything, anything. Anything I can show you to just convince you that I'm right and this is the right option and I'm true and I'm not dishonest and I keep my promises. And Ahaz refuses. Ahaz refuses. I don't want to tempt God. Oh, that's bad. We're kind of reminded of what Jesus said a long time later. But in this situation, I'm actually more reminded of Jesus' question to the Pharisees. He says, tell me about John's baptism. Was it from heaven or was it from men? You know, and the Pharisees are kind of like, oh. And it's as if they answer Jesus, you know, it's like, then the people will all be on Jesus' side anyways, so then there's going to be a riot. But if they don't, like if they choose heaven, then they're going to acknowledge that John the Baptist was right all along about proclaiming Christ's divinity, you know, as the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world in John. And so whatever the Pharisees say, you know, stuck between a rock and a hard place, whatever they say, they're going to admit that the government is really upon Jesus' shoulders, and that it's been there all along, since the time of the Ahaz. Behold, God says, skipping ahead to chapter 9, a virgin will be with child and bear a son. She will call his name Emmanuel, meaning God with us, or with us God. God and Isaiah are saying, you know, despite refusing to believe in God, God will act out of love for you anyways. And so he continues, before the boy even knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right, before he's morally accountable, those two nations are going to be laid waste. Once again, I see something that's pointing to God, everything pointing to God. I see God saying, here's a decision set before you, King Ahaz, a decision so easy to make, just to choose me, because I've provided everything that you have. Everything you have comes from me. Before some baby who's going to be miraculously born, by the way, even knows enough to even know what's right or wrong, before he even knows what's going to be right or wrong, the results of your easy decision are already going to be a full-fledged consequence. No. It's like irony almost. It's God saying, it's one of those signs. It's like a sign within a sign. It's like sign inception. It's
good.
The point I'm trying to make is that when God speaks, he speaks with signs. God's very breath created the universe, and Jesus himself is, help me out, Greek people, is it Logos or the Logos?
Logos.
Okay, you know, Jesus, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. God's Word is Jesus in flesh. He speaks his words. Everything we see around us is God speaking, and that continually, sustaining. You know, God sings over you, I think, comes from Zechariah 3:7. I don't remember the exact reference, but I like to think of it as God constantly singing creation into being. And then, of course, we have Jesus. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and last letters of the Greek alphabet. He is the Word of God itself. It's all connected to language. It goes on in chapter 9. He will honor Galilee of the Gentiles, where Jesus, coincidentally or not, spent his ministry, by the way of the sea, which was the actual road by the sea, you know, hundreds of years later, as it's called in Matthew chapter 4. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. The government will be on his shoulders. He'll be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. There will be no end to his reign. He'll be on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding him with justice and righteousness from that time on and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. So the ultimate fulfillment in this theme of God's grace and God's prevenient grace at that, God extending love and mercy first before we even have time to react, him always going before us, preventing us from making the wrong decision if we choose his grace, repeats itself throughout the entire scripture. And so when Jesus Christ grew up, he grew in favor and stature of men. And when he was on that cross, repeating the age-old self-crucifixion that we find of God and his servants in the Bible, he defeated sin and the last enemy of death. He showed that his kingdom is the right answer. It was another miraculous birth. Jesus raising from the dead, his resurrected presence with us even now. And a lot of times I forget. That's bad that I forget, I guess. But I forget that God is resurrected now and alive. And so that's the sign. Emmanuel, God with us. The God who's living miraculously before we could even do anything, fully human, identified with us. This whole entire book, divinely inspired, pointing us towards him. That's the sign, and that's what God would say to those people having a bad Christmas.